Good evening. Every Australian household will save hundreds of dollars on their power bills, but mortgage holders may be forced to wait longer for interest rate relief.
Treasurer Jim Chalmers handing down his third budget last night, with pensioners and small businesses to benefit, but eye-watering debt is on the horizon.
Emerging with a new surplus, new sales pitch and new subsidies for every household, whether battlers or billionaires.
We make no apologies for having broad support.
Every household, regardless of income, will receive $300 off their energy bills. Small businesses will receive $325.
Labor's Band-Aid budget.
This is a Band-Aid on a bullet wound.
Now, that's a Band-Aid on a bullet wound.
I think this is salt in the wounds.
But the Coalition will back the policy, meaning the savings will begin in July. Pensioners will have PBS medicines capped at $7.70 per script for the next 5 years. For everyone else, prices will stay at $31.60 until at least 2026.
Cost of living relief from the Treasurer for life-changing medicines.
Last night, emerging from his office with his family and a second surplus, the Treasurer insisting inflation will fall, but economists say there's no guarantee interest rates fall too, with national debt heading for $1 trillion in the next 2 years.
My key hope of the budget was that it wouldn't poke the inflationary bear. My fear now is that I think it has.
Conventional wisdom here says elections are about the future, and an early election battle here is all about the government's future made in Australia policy.
Modernising our economy and maximising our opportunities in a world of churn and change and on a path to net zero.
Including $6.7 billion for green hydrogen tax incentives, $7 billion of tax breaks for processing critical minerals, and $1 billion for battery and solar panel supply chains.
Australia should be at the forefront of that race because we have the best wind and solar and renewable resources of any country in the world.
Billions of dollars in royalty payments and all sorts of credit schemes. I just think if you're giving out billions of dollars to billionaires, we're not going to support that.
The opposition leader will get his chance with his budget reply tomorrow night. Charles Croucher, Nine News.
Workers are furious that their hard-fought battle for a pay rise has been delayed for up to 2 years. This is despite the industrial empire ruling 2 months ago their work had been undervalued and the Albanese government promising they'd be properly paid.
These tearful celebrations appear to have been premature. Aged care workers' joy at the Fair Work Commission awarding them a 13% pay rise replaced by disbelief.
Real hope that came out of the March decision that finally people would be earning a decent wage increase. Now we're being told that they have to wait.
It'll be 2026 before Australia's precious army of aged care workers will receive the extra pay they've long been promised.
We're understaffed as it is, and it just means a lot of hurt to everybody.
Karen's delayed wage hike is buried in the budget papers in a so-called contingency reserve. A pay rise for childcare workers is also in the works, but again, when and by how much, yet to be announced.
Work that forever has been undervalued, not recognised for how important it is and not paid properly.
Like aged care, childcare is a female-dominated industry, and for worker Sia Falesiu, the prospect of being better rewarded is felt deeply.
It actually means that I don't have to leave the sector. I can stay in a job that I love. It means I can move out. Mum, I'm moving out.
Early childhood educators do work that is incredibly demanding. It's skilled and it's valuable, but their wages have not reflected that.
The government's indicated it wants to carefully time the pay rises in the childcare and aged care sectors so as to not drain one workforce from the other. But there's understandable impatience for better pay to come sooner.
Especially when the government has just racked up another budget surplus worth more than $9 billion.
That equates to, in rough figures, the wage increase that should be paid to aged care workers.
Andrew Probyn, Nine News.
Meanwhile, the Albanese government's third budget had both winners and losers in it for Queenslanders. To break it down, Tim Avia joins us from State Parliament. Tim, a major boost for Queensland infrastructure projects.
That's right, Andrew, but I guess the most immediate and biggest winners in the budget for in Queensland will be Queenslanders with an energy bill, the federal government announcing more money off our energy bills. Now, this comes on top of the $1,000 rebate already announced by the state government. Last night, the federal government chipped in another $300 off energy bills on top of that $1,000. So $1,300 for every household in Queensland, plus seniors and concession card holders, many of them will receive more than $1,600 off their energy bills. Some economists have questioned the economic wisdom of this and the long-term impacts on the economy, but both governments backing it to be a winner with voters. As you mentioned, more money for some Queensland infrastructure projects. There was $431 million committed for the Coomera Connector. That money comes after a major cost blowout on the state-run project. Also, another $720 million. That's for the second Bruce inland freight route that will run from Queensland down to New South Wales. Some infrastructure projects which have already had announcements, $467 million for the Bruce Highway and $1.2 billion for the Sunshine Coast Rail Line. There was also some funding announcements for fire ants, $268 million over 4 years to be put through eradicating those pests, and another $900,000 for a much needed project, Hummingbird House, which provides care for sick Queenslanders with sick children. Not surprisingly, both political leaders here giving their sells today, the Premier backing the energy rebates, while David Crisafulli, the opposition leader, questioning the long-term infrastructure spend here in Queensland.
Both Labor governments here in Queensland and the Australian government both have decided to prioritise the most efficient way of easing the pressure on family budgets.
The federal government's chosen short-term political survival in southern states over long-term infrastructure planning in the fastest growing state.
Now, the Queensland state budget is due to be handed down next month, but the Premier today said not to expect any big, shiny new announcements in there. Obviously, the threat of inflation impacting both the federal and state budgets, but we'll bring you all that coverage when it happens. Andrew, Melissa.
Tim, thank you.